we have learned about the cells and cellular junctions. Now we will move to the third chapter of general physiology, and it is transport through cell membrane. Now, what is the need for the learning of transport through cell membrane? All the cells in the body require nutrients, oxygens, water, electrolytes, same as they should be get rid of the waste materials and metabolic end products. Cells achieve all this by means of transport mechanism. Now, what are these transport mechanisms? There are two basic transport mechanisms in our body, and they are passive transport mechanism and active transport mechanism. So first of all, we will learn about passive transport mechanism. So what is passive transport mechanism? It is the transport of substances along the concentration gradient or electrical gradient or both. That means electrochemical gradient. That means substances move from the higher concentration to the lower concentration regions. It is also known as diffusion or the downhill movement. It is also known as swimming in the direction of the flow of water. And most important thing is it does not need energy. So this is the passive transport mechanism. We will learn further about it. Passive transport or diffusion is of two types: simple diffusion and facilitated diffusion. This diffusion can be studied under three headings: simple diffusion through lipid layer, simple diffusion through protein layer, and facilitated or carrier mediated diffusion. So first of all, we learn about simple diffusion through lipid layer. We all know the lipid layer of the cell membrane is permeable only to the substances which are soluble in lipids. Which are these substances? They are oxygen, carbon dioxide, and alcohol. Diffusion through lipid layer is directly proportional to solubility of these substances in lipid. Now, we will see simple diffusion through protein layers. So, protein layer is permeable to water-soluble substances. Mainly electrolytes diffuse through the protein layer. Throughout the central lipid layer of the cell membrane, there are some pores. So, this is the central lipid layer. Proteins are like this. There are some pores. Integral protein molecules invaginate through these pores. This is the integral proteins, and they invaginate through these pores. These pores form channels for diffusion of water and electrolytes and other substances which cannot pass through this lipid layer. Each channel can permit only one type of ion to pass through it. So the channels are named after the ions which diffuse through these channels, like sodium channel, potassium channel, etc. Some of the protein channels are continuously opened. they are like this. These are protein channels. This is any kind of ion or molecule. They are continuously opens. These are known as ungated channels. And most of the channels are always closed. This is a closed channel. So the ion cannot move from here. Always closed, they are known as gated channels. They are opened only when required. Gated channels are also of three types. They are voltage gated channels, ligand gated channels, and mechanically gated channels. So first of all, we see about the voltage gated channels. So how is this channels? These channels open whenever there is a change of voltage or change in electrical potential. The best example is in neuromuscular junction. When axon terminal, when axon potential, sorry, reach the axon terminal, this is axon potential, this is axon terminal, it causes the opening of calcium channels. Now, these calcium ions diffuse in the, these calcium ions diffuse into the interior of the axon terminal from the extracellular fluid. So the axon potential can pass through it and activities occur. Now we will see the ligand gated channels. These channels open in the presence of some hormonal substances which are known as ligands. The example is during the transmission of impulse through the neuromuscular junction, acetylcholine is released from the vesicles. So these are the vesicles in presynaptic membrane. This is presynaptic membrane. This is postsynaptic membranes. So acetylcholine is released, is passed through the synaptic cleft and reach the postsynaptic membrane. And it causes the opening of sodium channels so that the sodium ions diffuse into the neuromuscular junctions and the axon potential passes through this. Now, we will see about mechanically gated channels. Now, mechanically gated channels are opened by some mechanical factors. The examples are channels present in the Pacinian corpuscles, which are known as pressure receptors, and channels present in the hair cells or receptor cells of organ of Corti and vestibular apparatus. So we will see the structure of Pacinian corpuscle. This is Pacinian corpuscle. This is Pacinian corpuscle. Now fiber attached to the Pacinian corpuscle. And this is the core fiber of Pacinian corpuscle. Now, when a Pacinian corpuscle is subjected to the pressure, it is compressed and it results in deformation of this core fiber. This deformation causes opening of sodium channels and development of receptor potential. Now, organ of Corti. So, the hair cells are like this. They are in this direction, either in this direction or they are in this direction. Sound waves cause the movements of these hair cells. They are present in cilia, which is a receptor organ in the ear. Movement of the cilia cause opening of potassium channels, which leads to the development of receptor potential. Okay, now we will move to facilitated or carrier mediated diffusion. It is the type of diffusion by which water soluble substances having larger molecules are transported through the cell membrane with the help of some carrier protein. This kind of transport is faster than the transport by simple diffusion. Glucose and amino acids are transported by facilitated diffusion. Glucose and amino acids molecules cannot diffuse through the channels because their diameters are larger than the diameters of the channels. Molecules of these substances bind with some carrier protein which are in the cell membrane. For example, we will see the glucose. This glucose is bind with the carrier protein, and the surface of carrier protein is facing towards the extracellular matrix. Now, some conformational changes occur in this protein and the carrier protein move towards the cytoplasm. The glucose is detached from the carrier protein and move into the cell. Factors affecting the rate of diffusion. So first of all, permeability of cell membrane. So the rate of diffusion is directly proportional to permeability of cell membrane. Okay, the second is temperature. The rate of diffusion is directly proportional to the temperature, because the increased temperature causes the thermal movement of the ions. So the diffusion occurs fast. The third is the rate of diffusion is directly proportional to concentration gradient. So higher the concentration gradient, higher the rate of diffusion. The next is rate of diffusion is directly proportional to solubility of substances. Now, the lipid soluble substances like oxygen and carbon dioxide are highly soluble in lipids. So the diffusion occurs very fast. Now, what are the substances or what are the factors which are inversely proportionate to the rate of diffusion? They are thickness of cell membrane. Larger the thickness, the rate of diffusion is slower. The next is size of the molecules. Larger the molecules, the diffusion is slower. The next is size of the ions. Larger the size of the ion, the rate of diffusion is slower. And the last is charge upon the ions. Heavier the charge or bigger the charge causes slower rate of diffusion. Now, these are the types of passive transport. Now, there are some types of special passive transport, and they are bulk flow, filtration, and osmosis. Bulk flow, filtration, and osmosis. These are the special types of passive transport. So first of all, we will see bulk flow. What is a bulk flow? It is the movement of large quantity of substances from a region of high pressure to the region of low pressure. We can see this in alveoli and pulmonary capillaries. Bulk flow is generally due to the pressure gradient of the substances across the cell membrane. Now, exchange of gases like oxygen and carbon dioxide in the lungs occurs by this bulk flow. The partial pressure of oxygen is higher in the alveolar air. So, oxygen diffuses from the alveolar air to the pulmonary capillaries. The partial pressure of carbon dioxide is higher in pulmonary capillaries and they are lower in alveolar air. So, carbon dioxide diffuses from pulmonary capillaries to the alveolar air, and by this the gases are exchanged. Now, next, filtration. So, what is filtration? It is the movement of water and solutes from the area of high hydrostatic pressure to the area of low hydrostatic pressure. Hydrostatic pressure is developed by weight of the fluid. Filtration process is seen at the arterial end of capillaries. So this is the arterial end of capillaries. They are in the tissues. This is the tissue and these are arterial capillaries. Fluid along with dissolved substances move from blood into the interstitial fluid by filtration. Filtration also occurs in the glomeruli of kidney. We all know about the structure of glomerulus. So, this is Bowman's capsule. These are glomeruli where arterioles comes, efferent and efferent. The blood passes through here and filtered from here and goes to renal tubules, from where urine osmosis. Is formed. What is osmosis? Osmosis is defined as movement of water or any other solvent from an area of lower concentration or to the area of higher concentration of these solutes through a semi-permeable membrane. Suppose we keep a semi-permeable membrane through both of which, through this. Now, in one part the solutes are less and in the other part the solutes are more. Now, water or any other solvent will move from the lower concentration to the higher concentration of this solute, but the semi-permeable membrane only permits the passage of water or the solvent. They do not permit the passage of this solute. Osmosis occurs whenever there is a difference in the solute concentration on the either side of the semi-permeable membrane. Now, the osmotic pressure. What is osmotic pressure? It is the pressure created by the solutes in the fluid. During osmosis, when water or any other solvent move from the area of lower concentration to the area of higher concentration, the solutes in the area of higher concentration gets dissolved in the solvent. This creates a pressure which is known as osmotic pressure. Normally, this osmotic pressure prevents further movement of water or any other solvent during osmosis. Now, what is reverse osmosis? It is the reverse phenomena. Reverse osmosis is a process in which water or any other solvent moves from the higher concentration to the lower concentration of the solute if an external pressure is applied on the area of higher concentration. Now, oncotic pressure or colloidal osmotic pressure. It is the part of osmotic pressure created by larger colloidal substances, particularly proteins. Albumin creates 70% of oncotic pressure, and the normal oncotic pressure is about 25 millimeters of mercury. Now, osmosis is of two types: endosmosis, which is movement of water into the cell, and exosmosis, which is movement of water outside the cells. So we are finishing passive transport.
We have completed three important chapters of general physiology. These are cell, cellular junction, and transport through cellular membrane. Please like, share, and subscribe our channel. And if you want to know any topic related to medicine, please comment in the comment section. We'll try to make a video on it and we'll publish it on YouTube. Thank you very much.